Good morning, and welcome to what many of us consider to be the most beautiful sanctuary ever created, especially during the seasons of Advent and Christmas. I'm Steve Porch, pastor here at St. Paul United Methodist Church in Fort Smith, Arkansas, and I am so glad that you have joined us for worship today. You know, it's been smaller crews than normal because of COVID, but crews have been at work preparing our facility for this journey through Advent into the celebration of Christmas and preparation for the revelation that comes at Epiphany, that Jesus Christ, the light of the world, is the Savior to all nations and all people. What an honor it is to worship with you today. I am glad you've joined us. I want to introduce a friend of mine, Captain Stacy Ganey from the Salvation Army, with a special message.
Thank you so much for thinking about the Salvation Army this year. With your help, at least 18 children are going to open Christmas presents on Christmas morning. And what a blessing that's going to be, not just for them, but for their parents. And what a stressful year it has been for so many people who have either lost their work, lost their jobs, or have been downsized, or their hours have been decreased. It's been a hard year. It's been a hard time for a lot of people. We see them coming in our front doors. They've asked for assistance for a lot of different things, and this thing that we get to do at Christmas, the angel tree, that you are helping with, is just amazing. And I want to thank you from the bottom of my heart for doing what you do and the generosity that you have shared with us this year.
Thank you, Stacy. And thank you, St. Paul, for your generous response to the request for help for the children and parents in our community. They will be blessed, and you are blessed to be a blessing. As we enter into week two of Advent and this Company's Coming series, would you join with me in this call to worship? Listen, the voice of God calls out across the ages. We hear and respond. We rise up to worship God from the valleys, the mountains, and the plains. Like a shepherd, God leads us and tenderly gathers us together. Comfort, O my people, says our God of love. The grass withers and the flower fades, but the word of our God will stand forever. Let us pray. O God, you call to us from the wild places. You call to us from the inner chambers of our hearts. We come in answer to your call. We come to pray, to praise, to learn of your love for all creation. Reveal your glory that we may see it together. Inform and inspire us to seek your kingdom on earth in our time. O King of Heaven, come. Amen. King of Heaven, come down.
adored Christ the everlasting Lord. Made in time, behold him come, offspring of a virgin's womb. Oh, mild he lays his glory by, born that man no more may die, born to raise the sons of earth, born to give them second birth. Hark, the herald angels sing, glory to a newborn king. The newborn king, king of heaven, come down. King of heaven, come now. Let your glory reign, shining like the day. Let your glory reign, shining like the day, King of heaven come. Yes, yes, Lord, King of heaven, come. Come right now, come in our midst, inhabit our praises.
Our lists are long, even in this strange mess in which we live these days. And we want to do it right, we want to be safe, but we also want to be able to enjoy the season. We've got a lot of work to do to put right what has gone wrong, to heal what is broken, to mend relationships, and to prepare for the company that's coming.
The prophet Isaiah reminded us that there is work to be done. Prepare the way of the Lord, make straight in the desert a highway for our God. When God comes in, then healing can be found. But we need to make the way. We need to open the door for God's steadfast love in our lives.
So, we light these candles as a sign of our faith that God's love is not far from us, and that we can clear the way for God to come and dwell with us. We light these candles knowing that company is coming.
O come, Emmanuel.
O come, thou wisdom from on high, and order all things far. To us the path of knowledge show, and cause us in her ways to go. Rejoice, rejoice, Israel.
Hear now this reading from the prophet Isaiah, chapter 40, verses 1 through 11. Comfort, O comfort my people, says your God. speak tenderly to Jerusalem and cry to her that she has served her term, that her penalty is paid, that she has received from the Lord's hand double for all her sins. A voice cries out, in the wilderness prepare the way of the Lord, make straight in the desert a highway for our God. Every valley shall be lifted up, and every mountain and hill be made low. The uneven ground shall be made level, and the rough places a plain. Then the glory of the Lord shall be revealed, and all people shall see it together, for the mouth of the Lord has spoken. A voice says, cry out. And I said, what shall I cry? All people are grass. Their constancy is like the flower of the field. The grass withers. The flower fades. When the breath of the Lord blows upon it, surely the people are grass. The grass withers. The flower fades. But the word of our God will stand forever. Get you up to a high mountain, O Zion, herald of good tidings. Lift up your voice with strength, O Jerusalem, herald of good tidings. Lift it up, do not fear. Say to the cities of Judah, here is your God. See, the Lord God comes with might, and his arm rules for him. His reward is with him, and his recompense before him. He will feed his flock like a shepherd. He will gather the lambs in his arms and carry them in his bosom and gently lead the mother sheep. Let us pray. Where there seems to be no way to end the conflict and violence in our time, we pray that you would teach us, O Christ, to prepare the way. Where we can see no way to provide for the needs of all people, we pray that you would show us, O Christ, how to prepare the way. Where we can find no way to work together for justice, we pray that you would change us, O Christ, until we prepare the way. Where we are unable to believe in a way to live simply, responsibly, and mindfully, we pray that you would inspire us, O Christ, to faith that prepares the way. In a world where we are tempted to see so many of our challenges as dead ends, we pray for a new vision, a new heart, and a new commitment to prepare the way for your reign, your grace, your shalom, and for the liberation, justice, and peace that you bring. Amen. Hey, everybody. Great to be with you this morning. You remember last week, I had a big mess on my desk, didn't I? Well, who do you think is responsible for cleaning up that mess? That's right. It's me. It's my mess. And I have to clean it up. We're still talking about cleaning up some messes today, but we're talking about it a little bit differently as we're getting ready for Christmas. You know, when you have a big event planned at your house or a big dinner planned at your house, sometimes your mom or your dad comes in and says, hey, everybody, we got to clean up this room. We got to clean off the table. We got to do this. And you go, but I didn't make that mess. And they go, yeah, but we need everybody's help. And you end up having to be part of the cleanup crew, don't you? I remember when my kids were growing up, there was this big purple dinosaur on TV, had a show, and his name was Barney. Any of y'all remember Barney? He used to sing this song called, it's, I love you, you love me, we're a happy family. Anybody remember that? Well, he had another song too, and that song really kind of reminds me of what we're talking about today, and it was called Clean Up Song. And it was clean up, clean up, everybody everywhere. Clean up, everybody do your share. You know, when we think about being part of a cleanup crew, we think we just got to clean up our own mess, right? And that it's after we've had some fun or after we've made that mess, it's just to put away those things. But really, sometimes being part of a cleanup crew means we have to help each other clean up all the messes. And it's not just about cleaning up the messes from the fun we just had or from the disaster that just happened. Sometimes it's like getting ready for that dinner at home. It's preparing for something else that's coming. You know, right now the church is in a season called Advent, and it's about preparing for Christmas, preparing for Jesus to come. And when we think about who needs to prepare for Jesus to come, we all do. Everybody, everywhere. Everybody do their share. How do we prepare for Jesus? Well, we sing songs. We read the Christmas story. We start thinking about how Jesus wants us to live and love each other. And we don't just think about it. We begin to actually live that way, to love each other and to share that love that Jesus has for us with each other. And we can do that in a lot of ways, but sometimes that means we got to get rid of the bad feelings that we have about other people, or the anger that we have when somebody's done something wrong and made us mad. We have to start cleaning up some of the things that keep us from loving each other, and we have to help make up for places in our world where other people haven't done so good at loving. Maybe there's somebody at your school that needs to hear that God loves them. Maybe there's somebody at your school that needs a special friend. And I know it's kind of hard this year because we're not meeting together very well or very often, but sometimes cleaning up, being part of the cleanup crew, means we help clean up where other people have messed up. So maybe that kid that everybody makes fun of needs a friend. And you can help clean up the mess by being a special friend to that person. You see, we don't have to wait till Christmas to live like Jesus is already here. We live because we know Jesus is coming. We live with love and clean up our messes because we're getting ready for Jesus. And we get ready for that Christmas story. We get ready for that exciting time. Not just the day that Santa Claus comes, but more importantly, the day that we celebrate Jesus' birthday. And we all have some getting ready to do. You know, people around here get our church ready for Advent and for Christmas. But we have to get our hearts ready, too. Get them ready to say, "Hello, Jesus. Welcome to my life. Help me live my life in love like you did." And you know what? Even if sometimes that other person's mess seems a little bigger than ours, or maybe our mess seems way bigger than theirs, we all need to be preparing for Jesus to come. We all need to get our hearts ready. Everybody, everywhere. So let's get ready for Christmas together so we can celebrate the coming of our special guest, Jesus, our Lord and Savior. Are you ready for Christmas? Let's get ready. Let's clean up our messes and get ready. Let's pray. Dear God, thank you for loving us. Help us get ready to celebrate Christmas. Help us be part of your cleanup crew. that gets our hearts right and our minds ready to worship Jesus at Christmas. Amen. Amen. We'll see you next week. Y'all remember, be part of the cleanup crew. Bye-bye. I know you've seen them out on the side of the interstate with their grabber sticks and their orange vest, sometimes a bucket or a bag, picking up the litter that's on the side of the highways. They're the cleanup crews, the litter crews, and sometimes they're volunteers, sometimes they're doing community service work, sometimes they're the residents of our jail system, but they're picking up our mess, and it's absolutely disgusting. The other day, I lost count of how many bags were on the side of the highway between Grand Avenue and Highway 71 South. It is absolutely terrible. But they're out here and cleaning up our messes. You know, the other day I had a revelation about the job of a cleanup crew. I want to share that with you here in just a moment. So let's say a prayer and let's head back to the sanctuary and we'll talk about it. Gracious, loving God, I give you thanks for this opportunity to be together today, for your word to be proclaimed. Use me as an instrument of your truth and grace. Move me out of the way so that you might be seen and touch all of our hearts. Amen. Well, last week we determined that this place is a mess. And by this place, we meant the church, the sanctuary, which it's much better now than it was last week. We meant ourselves, our lives, our hearts, and we meant our world. There's a lot left to be done. There's a lot left to be desired. There is a lot of chaos, misery, pain, mistrust, anger, fear, and just flat out messiness in our lives. And it doesn't take a genius to realize that we need some help. We need a major cleanup crew like the ones I was talking about on the side of the highway, picking up our trash and wiping out the evidence of our not so clean, not so responsible living. And wouldn't it be nice if we could always depend on someone else to do it for us? Wouldn't it be wonderful if somebody else could wipe the slate clean and eliminate the evidence and put things back like they belong? You know, sometimes I think that's what or who we are looking for during Advent. That someone else will clean up after the company has come and gone, when the lights have been turned out and the party's over, when the damage has been done. We look at the mess and think, well, someone's on the way who can fix it. Someone's on the way who will fix it, so I don't need to do anything. Jesus is coming and he'll just straighten out all this mess. Sometimes when we hear the words of the prophet Isaiah, we think it's God who's going to be doing all the lowering and the raising and the leveling and the smoothing out. But listen to his words again. It says, a voice cries out, in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord. In the desert, make the highway straight. Apparently they weren't from Arkansas. Lift up the valleys and make the mountains and hills low. And then the glory of the Lord shall be revealed. And the people will all see it. This is a word to the people of Israel, saying, prepare the way. Prepare the way and proclaim the good news. Of course, Isaiah was speaking to his people who had been in exile in Babylon for a long time. You want to talk about a mess. People who were looking for a way home, a way back to Judah, they had cried out to God, and God had heard their cries. They had confessed that they had forgotten to live as God's people, that their society had begun to cater to the power and influence and wealth, and many had suffered because of it. That they had forgotten to look out for the ones on the margins, and they had become a nation who in its entirety lived on the margins. That the systems in which they had placed their trust were no longer strong enough to support the life that they took for granted. They were a mess. And they caused a mess. And they were in a mess. But through the prophet, God spoke a word of promise and of hope, of steadfast love, like that of a shepherd tenderly caring for his flock. And yet the people weren't called to just sit back and wait and do nothing. They were called to prepare the way and proclaim the news and then travel from Babylon back to Judah. You see, it was more than just a call to clean up their past messes. It was a call to commit and to work together as God's people in order to make that journey back home, a process through which God's glory would be revealed. God's presence would be experienced and God's word would be made known. And you know what that would take? All of them. And each of them. Working with each other, even working with those around them, to prepare for something bigger than just their own well-being. And yes, it involved each one taking his or her own personal responsibility for their actions. But it also involved looking at their community as a whole, and then working together to remove the roadblocks and the obstacles that stood in the way of God's glory being revealed in and through them. They had stuff they needed to do. God's promise through Isaiah, although maybe not fully recognized at the time, would include more than just a return to the homeland. It included a return to the kind of community for which the people had been created in the first place, and a return to the kind of community that it called them to create. A community in which relationships connect and fulfill and bring life and joy instead of misery and death. A community where love and healing can be found and hope can be realized and even the voices of the voiceless could be heard. A place to call home, truly home. A home that can be found in the one of whom a man named John several centuries later would use those same kind of words to proclaim as the fulfillment of the promise. Mark's gospel account kicks off like this. The beginning of the good news of Jesus Christ, the Son of God. As it is written in the prophet Isaiah, "See, I am sending my messenger ahead of you who will prepare your way, the voice of one crying out in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord, make his path straight." John the Baptizer appeared in the wilderness proclaiming a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins. And people from the whole Judean countryside and all the people of Jerusalem were going out to him and were baptized by him in the River Jordan, confessing their sins. Now John was clothed with camel's hair, with a leather belt around his waist, and he ate locust and wild honey. He proclaimed, "The one who is more powerful than I is coming after me. I am not worthy to stoop down and untie the thong of his sandals. I have baptized you with water, but he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit." And this is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. And here, like in Isaiah's prophetic proclamation, the call is still to prepare the way. Which then leads to proclaiming the good news of the glory of God that is revealed. Good old John, he appears every year about this time to reveal to us the mess we are in. The mess to which we are often so blind. And then to remind us that maybe we haven't been paying enough attention. He dresses oddly to capture fascination and attention. He shouts to wake us up. He storms up and down the riverbank, inviting us to take a plunge. And he announces to us that, guess what? Company's coming. Get ready. And in response to company coming, John is asking something of us. He's asking us to join the cleanup crew, the road crew, in order to prepare the way for the one who is coming. There are curves to straighten out and potholes to fill and hills to level and messiness to clean. And yes, that includes working on our own messes, cleaning up our own hearts and lives, straightening out our own patterns of behavior, but it also includes working together to lower the mountains of systemic and corporate sin and pride, and to raise up the valleys of injustice, however and wherever that injustice occurs. There's a call to smooth out the pathway that leads people to wholeness. That same pathway that has been twisted in so many different ways in order to keep others from traveling it. Because this place is a mess, we discussed that last week, there's much work to be done. And because there is much work to be done, there is need for a cleanup crew, and that need is great. And because the need for a cleanup crew is great, John calls each and every one of us to sign up for it. To be partners, to be participants in the work of salvation by preparing the way for the Lord. And proclaiming the promise of the good news of God's love and grace. Okay, so here's my revelation about crews who pick up litter on the side of the highway. I always saw it as just an endeavor to clean up the mess that we had made in the past, so that the roadsides looked like they were supposed to again. You know, clean and uncluttered, unmarred by litter, as they were when they were created. And then not too long ago, I happened to be driving down a highway while those huge tractors were mowing the medians and the roadsides. But there was a problem. No one had picked up the litter first. No one had prepared for the mowers. And what was supposed to restore and reveal the original beauty of the roadside actually resulted in an even worse mess than there had been before, as the trash was torn to shreds and scattered all over the place. All over that freshly mown grass. And it was horrible looking. And that's when it hit me that the job of a cleanup crew isn't just to clean up the mess of the past, to get rid of the mess of the past, but to prepare for the coming of the mowers, which prevents the mess, which is sometimes hidden in the tall grass, from being revealed and scattered, and thereby allowing the beauty of the well-maintained right-of-way to shine. You see, when the mowers arrive, their intention is to show off the beauty and the splendor of the creation and reveal the glory of the Creator. But when the creation hasn't been properly prepared, then what is revealed is not beauty and splendor, but the hidden, not so hidden maybe, litter and filth. And there is nothing hospitable or welcoming or beautiful to anyone about a freshly cut right-of-way or newly mown lawn scattered with chopped up pieces of trash. I guess what I'm trying to say is that the cleanup crew's job is really more about preparation for what's coming than about just cleaning up from what's past. I think you're getting an idea of what I'm talking about. I mean, I know it would be better if we just didn't litter at all, but we do. We just do. And I know it would actually be better if we as individuals and as a community of faith didn't get ourselves in such messes, but we do. We just do. And I know that the one who is coming is completely capable of fully revealing as well as then fully cleaning that mess. But the calls of both Isaiah and John the Baptist on this second Sunday of Advent are don't wait. Don't wait until he's here to get prepared. Prepare the way now so that the glory is revealed. Commit now to working together to clean up the mess before the company comes. To pick up the trash before the mowers get there. How do we do that? First, we pray. We pray hard and heavy for God to reveal the places that are rough in our lives that need a little smoothing out. You know the ones I'm talking about. We pray to be awakened to the messy areas in our world that could use a little tidying up, whether they're our fault or not. And we pray that we might be open to seeing new ways of lifting up those who find themselves in the darkest valleys of life, and that we might also be open to being brought down from the mountains of pride and arrogance and status and privilege on which we as individuals and the church often find ourselves perched while overlooking those valleys. And we pray to be part of a cleanup crew that will help us pick up the litter in our lives before the mower arrives and reveals it for all the world to see. And we pray that we might prepare in such a way that it will be only the glory of the Lord that is revealed through us when he arrives. And second, we worship. We worship. We worship the one who has promised to come and yet who is already here. We worship the one who, who already knows the messes we've made and the messes we're in and the messes we'll get in, and who loves us anyway. We worship the one who baptizes us with love and grace and the Holy Spirit. We worship the one who has been revealed to us as Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, and who we're told whose word will stand forever. And third, we work. We commit to be part of the cleanup crew that makes a difference in our world, and we do that right now. Whether it's feeding the hungry or providing gifts for angels or fighting injustices or evils or divisions in our world, we work to lift others up. Whether it's softening our own hearts to the one who is coming or sharing his love in a way that softens others, we work to bring light to the darkness. And we don't wait to work until he arrives. We work while we're waiting so that when he arrives, his glory will be revealed and stuff won't be standing in the way. You see, company's coming. And there's work to do. And we need to make ourselves ready. We need to make our church ready. We need to make the world ready for the one who comes to lead us all home. And the joy is that we get to be part of that cleanup crew right now. We don't have to wait. And being part of that cleanup crew is no menial task. It's important because it's about revealing the glory of the Lord. And when we work that way, it's a sign that we are those who know that company's coming and we want to be ready. We want to be welcoming. We want to be good hosts to the one who is coming and to the people who might just come with him. So get ready. Because company's coming. Let's pray. Lord, our prayer today is that you will help us prepare the way for your coming so that nothing will stand in the way of your glory being revealed. And this we pray in the name of Jesus our Savior. Amen.
All is calm and all is bright everywhere, but in your heart tonight they're singing carols of joy and peace, but you feel too far gone and too far out of reach. Somewhere in your silent night, heaven hears the song your broken heart is crying. Hope is here, just lift your head, for love has come to find you. Somewhere in your silent night. Heaven's height to manger low, there is no distance the Prince of Peace won't go. From manger low to Calvary's hill, when your pain runs deep, his love runs deeper still. He has always loved you, child, and he always will. Somewhere the sun. Your broken heart is crying. Hope is you just lift your head for love.
We go forth today as part of God's cleanup crew. Not only cleaning up the mess in our own lives, but helping clean up the mess around us as we prepare the way for the coming of our Lord. As we proclaim to all the world that He is King. Amen.